Welcome back to Playground Sessions YouTube channel. I'm Phil. I'll be teaching you another song section today. And we're going to be looking at something in the jazz world today. We're looking at the intermediate level arrangement of Fly Me to the Moon, Frank Sinatra's version. And we're going to look at the A section from that arrangement. That section sounds like this. Okay. One, two, and one, two, set, go. Alright, you see that 100% pop-up score? If you guys aren't playing along in your own interactive Playground Sessions apps at home, then you're really missing out. You can tap this card above, though, if you want to learn about a free trial we're offering, where you can try this app for free, like a full paid member gets, for 30 whole days and no strings attached. So check that out. But in the meantime, let's go ahead and dig into this video. I'm going to break down this right-hand melody for you first. The key signature for this arrangement is, pretty simply, zero sharps, zero flats. That tells us we're in the key of either C major or A minor. Those are the related keys that share that key signature, okay? And you'll see, actually, in fact, when we dig in, especially to the left hand, that we're actually in the key of A minor. There's actually a little giveaway here in the right hand part as well. We see a G sharp down the way, measure 11. And what that tells us is that we're making an E minor chord into an E major chord. And the reason we do that, functionally speaking, is so that we can resolve to A minor. So, if we didn't see any G sharps, it might be more likely that we're in the key of C major. But that G sharp tells us that we want to resolve to A minor. All right, so we're in the key of A minor here. Now, let's talk about the time signature. Also pretty simple, 4-4, four beats per measure. So let's dig into this actual part. The first four measures we can see are just rests. This is kind of like the intro to the arrangement, and you'll hear when we hit play on the backing track that there's a little drum fill, a drum part going on that sets up the time for us. So we've got four measures of rest, then we jump into the vocal melody. And let's go over those notes now. We're gonna start with a high C with our fifth finger, way up here, two octaves above middle C. We're gonna walk down the scale. C, B, A, G, F, rest, A, C. Next measure, B, A, G, F, and then two finger comes over to E. And there's our first phrase. We're up here in an F position, walking down the scale. But then when we get to the final note, our two finger reaches over to E. Then we have a half rest to end that measure. Next line down, we start our next phrase. And check it out, our pinky's already on A, which is our next note. Walking all the way down to D and back up. Skipping G, going to A. Next measure, we now see that G sharp I mentioned with our fourth finger. Then three on F, two on E, one on D, two over again, this time to C. Then we're gonna have a quick rest and play a C sharp with our third finger. That's kind of a pickup note to the next section of the melody, which we won't be covering today. So that's it. There's two main phrases, and each phrase has a little bit of a hand position shift where we bring our two finger over towards the end of the phrase. That's it. So let's go ahead and try this. We'll do it with the backing track, and I'm gonna go ahead and do this at the full tempo. It's not very fast on its own, and we don't really have a ton of fast rhythms or hard jumps in this right-hand part. So let's go ahead and cue up our backing track at the full speed. Don't forget, we're starting with rest. So we've got four bars of rest. Here's two, three, get ready. One, two, set, go. Two over, look ahead. Sharp. There we have it, 100% for that right hand part. So now, when you're ready, let's shift gears over to this left hand harmony part. As we can see, the left hand also starts with four measures of rest, and then in measure five, we see our first chord. And we're gonna see this shape pretty often. Here's our first chord. looks like this, A, C, and G. Now the chord symbol says A minor, but more accurately, this is an A minor 7. Here's the root, here's the minor 3rd, we're skipping the 5th, and here is the minor 7, A minor 7. Root, 3rd, 7. Now we're going to be moving this shape around quite a bit. Some people may find it more comfortable to play this middle note with your 3rd finger, but technically I think the 4th finger is a little bit more traditionally the better choice, because you can tell that my wrist and my hand are a little bit more relaxed and evenly spread out. Whereas if I play that C with my 3rd finger, you start to see the bottom fingers bunching up and the top fingers a little too spread out, right? So I think it's best probably to use your 4th finger on this C. That's our first chord, and we're going to move down to our second chord, a D minor, also kind of this root, 3rd, and 7 voicing. D is the root, F is the flat 3rd, C is the flat 7, so a D minor 7. Same chord shape though, right? Third chord says G7, same shape. G is the root, B natural is the major 3rd, and F is the flat 7. So this is a G dominant 7 chord. Same shape though, right? Then moving up to a C root, same shape, C major 7. Chord symbol just says C, but more accurately, this is a C major 7 because we have the root, the major 3rd, and the major or natural 7th. So let's just recap the first 4 chords. Same shape, moving to a different root with our pinky each time. A minor, D minor, G7, and C major 7. Now, all of these are in root position. If we used inversions, it would make it a heck of a lot easier to move from one chord to the next because we wouldn't be jumping as much. However, using inversions would also make it a little more difficult in another way. As it is now, everything in root position, the chord shapes are identical as we move, so it's a bit easier to recognize those shapes. If we use inversions, each one would have a different shape. It might look a little something more like this. So there's some clusters in there, and it's taking on different shapes. Your hand is moving less, but the shapes are changing more often. So from an arranging perspective, we chose to keep all of these in root position to make the shapes easier to move to and to identify and recognize, okay? So let's move on. Our 5th chord, our next line down, says F in the chord symbol. Same shape, still continuing. It's an F major 7, and we're doing root, 3rd, 7th. But our very next chord, we change this pattern now. We're no longer doing that same pattern. The chord symbol says B minor 7 flat 5. Another way to say that would be a B half diminished. Okay, and the voicing that we've chose to use for this looks like this. This actually could be a D minor triad, right? In first inversion. We're actually missing out on our B. But the B can be found in our backing track in the bass part. So the B is represented here in our chord voicing. We're actually omitting that B. But with the B included, we could look at it like this, B, D, F, and A. Let's analyze this for a second. B, that's the root. D is the minor 3rd, so B minor. F is not the 5th of a B chord. That would be F sharp. So when we see an F, that's the flat 5th of the chord. We're flatting the 5th. That's why we see B minor with a flat 5th in the chord symbol. And A would be the flat 7 or the minor 7. So B minor 7 with a flat 5. We're omitting the B, and then that kind of looks like a D minor, right? And we're inverting it so that we're playing it like this. We've just gotten finished playing this F major 7 chord in measure 9, so this B minor 7 flat 5, all we need to do is move our top note from E down to D. Okay, let's move on. Next we see an E7 flat 9 in the chord symbol. Our voicing, we're going to play a root, a 5th, and a flat 7. Now there's a defining note missing here. Actually, there are two defining notes missing. The 3rd, which would be G sharp, and the flat 9, which we see spelled out in our chord symbol. Now the 9 is another way to say 2, So two here would traditionally be F sharp for an E chord, but we're flatting it, so that's an F natural. So an E7, flat 9 with the F. But the G sharp and the F are actually going to be present in the right hand melody. That's why we're not voicing it in the left hand. There's the third, there's the flat 9. But we'll get to that in just a minute when we put the hands together. For now, just know that we're playing this voicing for an E7 chord. Root, fifth, flat 7. All right, final measure. We actually now see two half note chords instead of a whole note chord. We're gonna play an A minor triad and second inversion. So we're keeping that E in the root in the bass there. And then we have an A7 voicing that looks like this. Now, this is almost a complete A7 chord, but we're actually not playing the A. Once again, the root is represented in the bass part, and that's very standard to play a chord without the root in jazz music, by the way. So as we're talking about jazz this month, you should get comfortable playing what are called rootless chord voicings. Here's the fifth of an A chord, here's the seventh, here's the third. We're not actually playing the A of the A chord. So that final measure, one more time, is A minor, A7. All right, guys, let's cue up our backing track. We'll go ahead and do it at the full tempo as well because, well, we see mostly whole note rhythms and because the tempo, even at full speed, is not super fast. So let's see what we can do here at full tempo. Don't forget, we're starting with rests. Two. Three. A one, two, set, go. Okay, sweet. We got 100% now on our right hand alone and on our left hand. So the final step in this video is going to be to put them together. And we're about to jump right into that, but I want to remind you one time before we do that we're doing a free trial of our interactive app. You can find a ton of other jazz songs in the app as well. We've also got blues, R&B, and all of the kind of things that jazz helps to influence, right? So if you're a fan of any of that stuff, you can find it in the app. You can also find this song in different difficulty levels as well. If it's too tough for you, we've got a rookie beginner level arrangement. We've also got an advanced level arrangement where the left hand's doing much more jazzy chords, the right hand's playing more syncopations, and we're just much closer to the Frank Sinatra version that you may be familiar with. There's also a ton of other stuff in the app, including video lessons by myself, by David Sides, by Harry Connick Jr., by the way. Pretty sweet. There's a ton of stuff in the app and it's worth checking out because we're doing a 30-day free trial where you can try everything just like a paid member, but you don't have to pay anything up front. That's how confident we are that you're gonna be digging the app. All right, so if you haven't tapped it already, tap the card above that says, "What are you waiting for?" And you can open it in a new tab because we still have a little work to do in this video, right? Let's go ahead and do that now so you can move on to the app when you're done and finish this out on your own. All right, let's put these hands together. Let's give it a shot now at the slow tempo first, and once we're feeling good there, we can speed it up to full tempo. Here we go. One, two, one, two, set, go. There we go, 100%. We're almost there, guys. So let's go ahead and speed this up, but don't be in a hurry. If you still need a little extra practice at the slow speed, that's all right. Pause, rewind, and play back as many times as you need to feel comfortable there. But when you're ready, guys, this is Fly Me to the Moon, the intermediate level arrangement, A section, hands together, full speed, here we go. Okay. One, two, a one, two, set, go. One, two, All right, we did it, you guys. There's 100% across the board for this section. I encourage you to continue this one in the app. You won't see a video lesson with me walking you through each section like I've done here in today's video, but you will have something even more valuable, and that's that real-time feedback. The app grades you as you play, spits up scores, shows you exactly what you need to work on. It's pretty great. That's it, guys. I'm Phil, and I'll see you soon, I hope, for the next video lesson.
The features you saw on screen today can be at your fingertips with the Playground Sessions app. Co-created by music legend Quincy Jones, Playground teaches the piano with interactive feedback and gaming features, all while using your favorite songs. All right, guys, I'm Phil. Hit subscribe so I can see you for the next video.